Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, colleagues, students, friends. I'm very, very happy to be able to welcome you here this evening to the Helix, to the first in what we hope will be a series of lectures concerning the media and the public. In the School of Communications and ECU, obviously, we're very conscious of our responsibilities. First, to the students, to provide them with the skills and the opportunity for them to hone their skills and their critical thinking so they can go out into the world and be the best that they can be. Our responsibility to society, to provide space for academics to research the latest developments in media practice and policy and impact. And also to provide a space for society itself to talk about the big issues that face the country and the world as they do now. We live, as the Chinese might say, in interesting times. A deep, deep social and economic crisis combined at the same time with a deep crisis in the media itself, struggling for audiences, struggling for revenue, struggling for authenticity. So we hope that this lecture series will provide a space where these big issues can be debated. Tonight is only a starting point, and we are deeply, deeply honored that the new Director General of RTÉ, an alumnus of DCU School of Communications, Noel Curran, is going to be here tonight to deliver his first big strategic vision of public service media in the coming years. I'm not going to take very much time, but I'm going to ask a former colleague of ours, Brian Trench, himself an eminent media practitioner and critic, to introduce both Noel Curran, the man, and the issues that he faces. Brian Trench, thank you.
Thank you, Patrick. Good evening, all. Thank you for the honor of chairing this first in what I hope will be a continuing series of lectures and possibly other formats, debates and fora on issues in the media. Many of us are here as media educators or media researchers, obviously very many media students and all of us, and some also as professionals in various capacities. And we do spend a lot of our time worrying and talking about the problems that the media face and the changes they're going through. And Patrick's just hinted at some of the issues that that face us. But many of us in society as a whole, and here no doubt as well, relate to the media primarily as users, perhaps also as critics and complainers in the private fora of family and colleagues and friends. And we have different perspectives, therefore, represented within this gathering and in society at large on the media. And in a lecture series under the title, The Media and the Public, we will need to reflect on and reflect these various views. There are, and Patrick has already touched on this, there are many reasons to be concerned about the state of our media, not necessarily their survival, because media, I guess, will always be with us in some form, but their mix, their diversity, their organization, their quality, and their business models. The economic recession, the decline in consumer spending, the decline in advertising revenue to the media, these are all affecting the economic viability of many media. Concentration of media ownership and the rationalization of media workforces are affecting how media tell their stories and indeed our stories, and the range of views that media consumers have on offer. Technological developments are allowing new players into the game, but also crucially, they're opening established media more and more to the kind of scrutiny that they purport to apply to other institutions in society. These factors and these issues have been reasonably well discussed in recent years, but in considering the media and the public, the title that for the lecture series, we need, I think, to balance our concern about the media and how it's made up and how they operate with attention to the public and to ensuring that they are heard. And perhaps we should start by insisting that just as the media are plural, despite many people complaining about the media is all something, the media are plural, well, so too are the publics. And it may be useful, I think, to think of the publics in the plural of the term. Tonight's speaker will explore notions of public service media. And the choice of term is itself interesting because public services tend to be attached only to broadcasting or to broadcaster, rarely to other media. But public service broadcasting, despite many years of its recognition as a term and as a concept, is itself a contested concept? Does it apply to broadcasting organizations by virtue of their legal status or their charter or their ownership status? Or does it apply to certain forms of program or initiative? Was yesterday's magnificent Messiah in the Dundrum Shopping Center all the more magnificent for somebody like myself who happened to be driving the car and it came as a complete surprise? I hope you enjoyed that surprise yourselves. Was that magnificent Messiah performance in Dundrum Shopping Center an example of public service media performance more or less than all the very many hours of sports coverage across the various channels over the weekend? As I say, I think we need to pay attention to the publics, to their needs, to their concerns, to their apprehensions, to their anxieties, and to their desires, not just in respect of media, but indeed in respect of developments in society and economy in the whole. If this is a time of great challenges for media, as we've already heard, it's also a time of great challenges for many people across social sectors, various social sectors, who live in a heightened sense of uncertainty and of risk about their personal welfare, about their employment, if indeed they have any, and indeed even about their homes. And there are publics who are totally disenchanted with their political and community, and indeed their political community leaders and their media organizations, just as there are publics who have become more active in civic life and more active indeed in media production of various kinds. So in all these circumstances, the media are very seriously challenged in responding to public needs. There's a marked differentiation, even polarization, and indeed internal contradiction within publics about their attitudes to and their relationships to media. In surveys of public trust, journalists fare almost as badly as politicians, and that's saying something. Yet journalists and other media professionals are among the very first ports of call when communities and interest groups have a grievance or an achievement that they wish to bring to attention, and I'm not just thinking of calls to Liveline. And the work of media professionals continues to be read and watched and listened to as indispensable information on what's going on around us. Both because media face very great economic pressures and still high public expectations, these are indeed challenging times for media that aim to be of public service. We're very fortunate then to have an early exposition by Noel Curran in his new role as Director General of the vision he has for public service media. And we're happy to welcome Noel back to where he studied communications over 25 years ago. And I've just learned that his thesis topic in 1987 was on, guess what, the crisis in public service broadcasting. He swears he hasn't read the thesis since, but anyway, if you look hard enough in the library archives, you might just find it. Noel was one of that first generation of media students, many of whom are now in their 40s and 50s and have become leaders in their respective sectors. DCU today is a very different place from the NIHE of that pioneering period. But we hope we are continuing to provide the stimulation for the very good students that we are lucky to have to come to us to develop their full potential. And if that is their aim, to shape the industries and organizations in which they work. And importantly, to be of public service. Noel Curran worked as a business journalist after he left NIHE, and then he joined RTÉ as a television reporter. Later a producer and editor. He has worked in entertainment and in news and in current affairs, notably with Primetime and setting up Primetime Investigates. He became part of the RTÉ executive as managing director of television in 2003, and he now heads that executive board as director general since February of this year. And just by the way, the current managing director of television is another DCU graduate, Glenn Killane. As Director General, Noel has immediately had to enter discussions with RTÉ staff about cost reductions and strengthening the technology and the commercial strategies. I note with particular interest that he has plans to improve public access to RTÉ archives, something that will be very welcome among media educators and researchers. We're very glad that Noel's taking a step back from the heat of the kitchen to take a broader view, so I ask you to join me in welcoming our speaker on the future of public service in Ireland, Noel Curran, Director General of RTÉ.
Thank you all very much. I just want to read my thesis from 25 years ago. No, I'll spare you that. Nice to see so many people here and so many students, particularly. I want to thank Patrick and Brian for their introduction, and Dublin City University for inviting me here this evening. I'd like to congratulate them on the establishment of this new lecture on media and the public. As a past student, I'm delighted that DCU is taking the lead in this always changing and often contentious area of public debate and public policy. I hope tonight that I can provide some food for thought. I come here, just to warn you, burdened with the curse of all public lecturers. It's not an empty auditorium or an unfinished script, it's a head cold. It's a man head cold, I hasten to add, which means I'll probably be dead in the morning, but I'll ask for your forbearance with the cold, if not necessarily with the speech. In the minds of every Irish citizen, and most of us in the room tonight, certain questions resonate very forcefully. How much have we lost in the turbulence of the recession and amid the collapse of our national finances? And crucially, how much more have we yet to lose? Not just personally, but also in terms of national institutions and our faith in them. So much has changed, fallen from grace, or gone. So have big business presences, Waterford Glass, the Sunday Tribune, Dell Manufacturing, and many smaller businesses in every community, town, and village across the country. We all hear, and many of us know daily, how we have lost our economic and fiscal sovereignty. But there are certain things which we maintain a large degree of sovereignty over, for now. We are sovereign in information. Irish people can, if they choose to, still get their news, debate, discussion and argument mainly through Irish-owned and Irish-run media. We must not underestimate how crucial that is. And we are also still very largely sovereign in culture. For all that we consume and enjoy global culture and entertainment, we still have our own way of doing things, our own sense of humour, and our own brand of creativity. We speak to each other and understand and amuse each other through our own cultural context and our own unique creativity as much as others. So information and cultural creativity, in these two things, we remain sovereign and independent. Stripped of these, we really would be stripped bare. The space occupied by the media, the space of information and culture, is in itself critically and fundamentally important to our sense of ourselves and forms the bedrock of our identity. Nothing in Ireland bridges the worlds of information and culture or operates with greater trust and popularity than does public broadcasting or public media, as we must now call it in the digital era. RTÉ is the main source of public media in Ireland. Tonight I want to address how RTÉ can and must remain vital within that space into the future, while being part of a diverse and vibrant media environment. And perhaps most crucially, how public media should and can be funded. Indeed, whether it should be funded at all. That's the real debate for the future, and I want to take some time in discussing that tonight as well. Independent research has shown that RTÉ's news and information services are used by and trusted by more Irish citizens than any other media services. And RTÉ's underpinning of arts and culture, music, drama, sport, and independent media production are critical to the vigour and the popularity of those key parts of Irish life. The space that RTÉ lives in, breathes in, and operates in is fundamental to our nation, to our society, and to our citizenship. I really believe that. RTÉ is a keeper of much that is still ours. But as I mentioned, all is changing fast, and RTÉ, to continue to fulfil its public service obligations, will have to adapt to deliver existing and new digital media services of quality that the public have a right to expect, to have clearer output priorities that underline our public value, fulfil the needs of the public we serve, and differentiate RTÉ from its international and domestic competitors. And in parallel, like everybody else, reduce our costs and optimise our commercial potential in order to derive maximum value for money for the licence fee paying public. These are huge challenges which will see a different RTÉ emerge in the coming years. A leaner, more focused, more competitive, more open, partnership-based organisation with an enhanced digital presence. The challenge is to ensure, amid profound technological, societal, and economic change, that RTÉ continues to be a public good, accessible to all, trusted, and relevant to the everyday lives of Irish people. Next year, RTÉ will be celebrating 50 years of television in Ireland. I'm told that I'm the first Director General of RTÉ who was born after the inaugural broadcast from the Gresham Hotel in 1961, although I do feel much older. I come from a generation that has experienced broadcasting in a fundamentally different way to any that has gone before. RTÉ today sits within a society, economy, and media landscape that are unrecognisable from when it was established. From being an isolated country on the margins of Europe, we joined the EEC, opened our doors, and entered a confident dialogue with the world. Foreign investment flowed here with all the skills, innovation, and diversity that came with it. We moved from being poor to being wealthy and part of the way back again. Our troubles in the north have been replaced by peace. We have seen the ebb and flow of our people through immigration and emigration. We have seen our institutions challenged, our confidence shattered, our trust broken, and the political landscape redrawn, all in 50 years. RTÉ has been companion to, participant in, and observer of all this change. It has been our duty to investigate it, report it, question it, reflect it, and provide platforms for commentary on it. That's why we exist. But while we were playing that role, the very market we operate in ourselves was changing rapidly too. From being one of the few media organisations operating domestically, we are now one of the many. Irish people have always had a strong appetite for media, and that hunger has resulted in a very crowded, diversified, and competitive media market. And nothing has enabled this explosion quite like technology. Just recently, we heard that Twitter had decided to open up an office in Ireland. Here it joins its giant cousins, Facebook and Google, in shoring up Ireland's reputation as an international digital hub. But no one needs the physical presence of its offices here to remind us of its impact on our daily lives. When a company name becomes a verb in less than a year, it has made a global impact. It's only the latest in a string of technological iterations of the past few years that have made the future of all media exciting, vibrant, diverse, but much, much harder to predict. Last year, for instance, 15% of all page impressions on RTÉ's web services were made on mobile technologies. Just 12 months later, that figure stands at over 40%, a staggeringly rapid increase that few could have predicted. The number of internet connections in Ireland increased by 300,000 in the past year. Broadband speeds of up to 100 megabits are now available to many households. The time spent online by Irish consumers this year stands at 3 hours per day. That's 1 hour more than it was just a year ago. I could spend all night giving you statistics similar to these, but I'm sure you're all aware of it. You cannot help but be. So, the future of broadcasting, therefore, should be clear. It's all going online, the future is in the cloud, and traditional broadcast media, both television and radio, are soon to be relics. Antiquated curiosities will watch with bemused amusement on future online versions of Reeling in the Ears. Well, yes, until you consider the following. Despite the increase in online and mobile usage, despite the explosion of social media, consumption of television in Ireland is actually growing. Year on year, more people are spending more time watching television, not less. And perhaps most perplexingly, television viewing among the younger generation, that most elusive market segment of all, is actually up. RTÉ Radio 1 has held its large national audience for the past 3 years running. In fact, radio listening in general in Ireland remains robust. So this should give you some sense of the complexity of the broadcasting and media landscape that faces us all as we look ahead into the future. While it is true that online media consumption is growing rapidly, it's also true that the vast bulk of broadcast media is still consumed in live and linear formats. All of our audience research indicates that this will continue to be the case for the short to medium term. It seems, so far at least, that social media is adding to the media landscape, but is not necessarily displacing broadcast services. In fact, it could be helping some of them. Indeed, a feature of the current presidential election is that many viewers for the first time are watching the live debates while following and contributing to the live commentary on Twitter, Facebook, and other social media. Much the same experience is found as families gather to watch reality shows, big sporting events, and entertainment spectaculars, sharing the experience as groups, but interacting individually. What is absolutely clear is that old certainties and simple assumptions about the audience and content no longer apply. The audience has just become an awful lot more sophisticated, and so must the broadcaster. Advances in digital technology have not been restricted to the online world. The television market in Ireland has seen an exponential increase in digital television available to Irish audiences. 75% of Irish households now receive multi-channel digital television services, accessing hundreds of channels. Never in our history has global media had such access to Irish citizens. I want you to just pull back for a moment, and observe the penetration and influence of the range of media sources in our daily lives. Just imagine an average day of viewing, listening, and web browsing, where you don't use any of RTÉ's services. You might begin with Ireland AM on TV3. TV3 is owned by Doughty Hanson, the multi-billion-pound London-based private equity firm. You might then buy the Irish Independent on the way to work. The Independent is, of course, part of Independent News and Media, which had revenue of over €600 million last year. At your coffee break, you might listen to Dublin's FM 104, which is owned by UTV Media Group, which operates 21 commercial radio stations in Ireland and the UK and UTV television. Over lunch, and we're just up to lunchtime, you might check the news headlines on Sky News, part of the B Sky B group, which took in almost €7 billion last year. You might access one of the 300 television channels Sky is currently offering. Sitting at your desk, you might then use Google to check for the latest football scores. Google is a €16 billion company with the most popular website in Ireland and a rapidly growing Irish online income. You then tweet your dismay at those scores on Twitter, a $7 billion worldwide phenomenon. In the afternoon, you check to see who has poked you on Facebook, a site with over 800 million active users. On the way home, you listen to Matt Cooper on Today FM, owned by Dennis O'Brien's Communicore, which operates 40 commercial radio stations in 8 different countries. After dinner, you tune in to the BBC, the largest public service broadcaster in the world, with an income of over €5 billion. You access the BBC via your UPC cable service, which is, of course, part of Liberty Global, the largest cable company in the world outside of the US. And finally, before going to bed, you log on to iTunes to buy the Rihanna single, Complicated. iTunes is, of course, an Apple service, a company that now vies with ExxonMobil to be the most valuable in the world. All of this is now available to an Irish audience in a single day, any month of any year. Ireland is a small market, but with some very big players. International trends of globalization of content delivery and concentration of domestic ownership are already established here. So to those who would say that RTÉ is too big, too dominant, or too controlling in this market, I would say pause for a moment, take a step back, and see the real elephant barging its way into our living rooms. The Ireland we live in now is a society with a complex media landscape that is dynamic, international, and highly competitive, a huge proportion of which is operated by international media companies whose primary motive, as James Murdoch said a number of years ago, is unashamedly profit. And commercial companies should have a profit motive. That profit motive has driven a huge range of technological innovation and other innovations in our industry. Those that took the risks have reaped the rewards, and good luck to them. But the pursuit of commercial return does not always sit comfortably with the wider needs of society. At this time in our history, given our economic vulnerability, given the rise of global media players, given the concentration we've already seen of ownership in Ireland, The pursuit of commercial imperatives cannot be allowed to determine public policy on public service broadcasting. Now, more than ever, amidst all this change, fragmentation, and uncertainty, there is a need for a publicly owned media service with a strong Irish voice. Not in a homogenous voice, but a voice accessible to all. A voice that articulates Irish stories. A voice that relays Irish experiences and allows for national debate and conversation. A voice that addresses, as its priority, the challenges facing this society and this country, and that is a national focal point at times of celebration and crisis. A voice that offers an Irish perspective on the world. A voice that, as I said earlier, is a daily keeper of much of what is ours: culture, history, language, and identity. Above all, we need a media service that does all of these things, but is accountable not to shareholders, individuals, or to a particular government of the day, but to the public. Of course, central to accountability is trust. And trust, particularly a broad public trust, is first and foremost earned. Often by being presented by a sharp contrast can we see the inherent value of services that have become so much a part of our lives. It's interesting, for example, that through the summer, as the News of the World and News International hacking story broke in the UK, the BBC looked and felt more important, more essential, without having to do anything or even say a word. Relevance and popularity are essential for all media organisations. Because unless people watch, listen, read, or use your services, there's very, very little point in offering them. But trust is the critical measure for public service broadcasters. For RTÉ, trust is our currency, and it's something we keep a close eye on. Our latest research shows that 72% of people consider RTÉ trustworthy, a figure that has grown since 2009 through a period when trust was collapsing in other national institutions. We see that trust being expressed at times of particular difficulty. People find themselves reaching for the familiar. During the volcanic ash chaos, the Murphy report, the budget, the banking crisis, the winter freeze, and any uncertain times, ratings for RTÉ services soar. This is how loyalty is fostered and maintained. But trust is not arbitrary. For trust to be durable, the institution that earns it must be bound by an appropriate system of checks and balances. RTÉ now operates by an agreed set of principles and within a complex regulatory framework underpinned by broadcasting legislation that has evolved as much as Ireland has changed. It is important tonight that I explain some of this to give people a comfort that they do have a say in how that trust is maintained and monitored. Since 1926, and broadcasting, and public service broadcasting in particular, has received the sustained attention of policymakers and politicians. There have been 21 acts or amendments and a number of other statutory instruments related to broadcasting over the period, culminating and consolidated very recently in the 2009 Broadcasting Act. At EU level, the issue of public service broadcasting has also received considerable attention from policymakers, and much of it has informed national legislation across the Union. The present model of public service broadcasting in Ireland, what is expected of it, how it is regulated, and how it is sustained and funded, is not some accident of history or some neglected policy backwater in need of a fresh look. But it is clearly the sovereign will of the Irish people, reaffirmed in law and enacted by Parliament just 2 years ago. Crucially, the Act places RTÉ for the first time under a regulator, the Broadcasting Authority of Ireland, and gives the authority wide-ranging powers to hold RTÉ accountable on behalf of the public. The RTÉ Public Service Statement sets out 5 pages on how RTÉ sees its role, the principles it will observe, and the services it will provide. This is a public statement, a public contract that RTÉ enters into with its audience that no commercial broadcaster commits to. Independence of vested interests, inclusivity, accountability, high quality and standards, operate within legal and democratic remit, express our cultural diversity, and create a better understanding of the wider world. This is what shapes our schedules. This is what guides our decisions. This is the framework we work to every single day. Given the uncertainty we all face, the collapse of trust in markets and financial systems, the social upheaval caused by revelations of our past and breakdown in institutions, these principles are more relevant than ever. RTÉ won't always live up to these principles, but surely it is important, now more than ever, that we have a public institution at the heart of Irish life that is determined to reach for and attain the highest standards. Each year, RTÉ lays out how it intends to make these principles manifest in its operations. In January of this year, RTÉ published its commitments for 2011. The document includes 170 individual commitments. It is worth taking just a little time to give you a few of the examples. RTÉ will deliver almost 3,000 hours of news and current affairs across radio and television. RTÉ performing groups will deliver 180 public performances and 77 educational performances. RTÉ will deliver 650 hours of young people's programming for television. RTÉ will ensure that home or indigenous production comprises 65% of our peak time hours on RTÉ1. RTÉ will launch an 18-month campaign to educate the public about DTT and Serviu. These are just a few examples from a long and detailed list of obligations that RTÉ is required to commit to each year to earn its role as a publicly funded broadcaster. These obligations simply do not apply to commercial broadcasters. I would not stand here today and say to you that RTÉ is the only broadcaster on the island that engages in public service broadcasting. Commercial services do provide some public service broadcasting, but they do it ultimately because they choose to, because it suits their very legitimate profit motive, either in terms of advertising return or as part of a case to access public funding. They can come and go on this. They can change their minds. They can change their strategy. New owners of any of these companies may take them in a totally different direction. The previous owners of TV3, Canwest, invested very little in Irish production. The current owners have a policy of more Irish investment, and I commend them for that. But who's to say what the next owner's strategy will be? RTÉ doesn't have that choice. We are required in law to offer the broad range of services that we provide, and we are accountable to the public in how we provide them. There are those who argue that public funds should be used only for those programmes that the market will not provide. Determine RTÉ's remit by market failure rationale alone, they argue. In other words, you do what we don't want to do. Or, to put it more directly, you do whatever doesn't make money for us. This is the crux of the public service argument that has been going on since I entered the world of media over 20 years ago. There is a lack of honesty, or perhaps more generously, a lack of realism from those who want to see RTÉ's remit narrowed to certain types of output. Such perceptions have only one inevitable outcome, the eventual marginalisation of RTÉ as a national broadcaster, and with it, the concept of public service broadcasting that it adheres to. Those who argue that publicly funded broadcasters should not be concerned about ratings, should concentrate on what the market chooses not to provide, will be the first ones to question, when those audiences dwindle, why we should spend public monies on a minority broadcaster that few people listen to or watch. I understand the attraction, though. While media is an important part of the social fabric of our society, that very importance makes it attractive to business. Media for many means financial opportunity alone. The opportunity to reach such large audiences in an increasingly interactive and transactional way has meant that many venture capitalists, entrepreneurs, and investors will understandably find it an attractive proposition. Public service broadcasting becomes very inconvenient looking through that lens. Richard Branson, Rupert Murdoch, and Dennis O'Brien are only some of the names in this island who have made their fortunes, or part of them, from involvement in media. It's little wonder, therefore, that those in the private sector would cast an envious eye at the public service organisations and argue that they should have a slice of the pie, or in some cases, the whole pie. Ireland needs a diverse media sector, and I say again that I absolutely understand and commend the commercial sector's profit motive. They need to be helped in terms of achieving this. But this drive to improve their bottom line cannot be allowed to determine the shape of public broadcasting. To do that is to cross a regulatory Rubicon. Once crossed, it becomes impossible to get back where you started and undo the damage done. It's worth reflecting on what we would not have if we did not have a not-for-profit public service media organisation in Ireland such as RTÉ. We wouldn't have 250 million annual investment in Indigenous television and radio. We wouldn't have opportunities for the 500 actors and 350 classical musicians that our drama and performing groups support each year. Irish audience wouldn't have over half of their peak time viewing being produced in Ireland by Irish programme makers. We wouldn't have a national Irish language radio station service, cutting edge investigative reporting, or an extensive network of regional reporters, crews and programming. Nor would we have the bringing together of Ireland and the rest of the world around events like the visit of the Queen and President Obama earlier this year. No commercial broadcaster would make a decision that they were going to lose 3 million euro in those events. It simply wouldn't be worth their while. The broadcast of the events internationally undoubtedly benefited Ireland Inc. But what chief executive of any commercial broadcaster could face their board of directors and say, listen, we've decided to lose 3 million over the next 5 days, but don't worry, Ireland will be better off. And yet look at the return for Ireland. Over 30 countries worldwide accessed and used the RTÉ footage for free, including our competitor in this market. Those who can deny that broadcasting made those visits more intimate, yet more shared, more historic, more impactful, more unifying. Another example of the wider benefits of public investment in a national broadcaster is the provision of digital terrestrial television, DTT. The government expects to generate up to 500 million euros in a spectrum sell-off as a result of Analogue Switch off. Yet this can only occur because of RTÉ's investment of 70 million euros in building, operating, and promoting the replacement DTT service. No commercial operator in their right minds would have taken this on, and the country would have been left without a national digital infrastructure, without the predicted exchequer returns, and perhaps most importantly, without a free-to-air television service. Scale gives RTÉ the capacity to do big things in the public interest, important things, things that just could not be done otherwise. And just because RTÉ do things that others would find neither popular nor profitable, it doesn't mean that we can ignore ratings. We know that we are only relevant when we are connecting. There is no contradiction in our remit to serve all and yet be popular. Often public service broadcasting is considered as worthy but dull stuff, the stuff that no one watches. I have never believed this. The idea that public service programming doesn't carry with it a huge attraction would be to do our audience a disservice. Irish people are a beautifully complex people with a great appetite for media, with strong and diverging views, and with an education that demands high standards of our storytellers. Time and again, we have seen that well-produced, creative, story-driven programmes, which intelligently analyse and parse elements of our society, rate strongly, and can create the debate that drives our society forward. This is why RTÉ has never been, and in my opinion, should never be, reluctant to place those programmes at the heart of our schedules, where they are available to the most people. It is also untrue to say that only programmes of weight and perceived worthiness constitute public service. RTÉ has an obligation in law to inform, to educate, and to entertain. That is why RTÉ is proud of its offerings, from the big entertainment shows to the sporting occasions, which give the nation an opportunity to connect through the talents and trials of others. It is why we value satirical programming that allows us laugh at ourselves, and it is why we attempt to display all that is best about us when it comes to music, literature, poetry, and the arts. To truly serve the audience in its deepest sense, we must serve them completely. There is a public value in those programmes that serve the purpose of lifting the spirit, that display and highlight the culture and creativity of our most talented. And it is often these programmes that our audiences flock to in most numbers and that generate the most revenue for RTÉ. And that revenue is important to us. It is RTÉ's role to supply a complete service. To do this, we must generate commercial income, which along with the licence fee funds our services. This is an intrinsic part of our remit. The licence fee that the public are legally bound to pay for our RTÉ services covers approximately 50% of the cost of providing them. The other half must come from commercial activities, which, as I say, we are required in law to earn by selling our airtime, our content, and our services. This model drives maximum value for the licence fee by forcing RTÉ, through a commercial imperative, to remain close and responsive to its audience, while at the same time fulfilling broader societal goals. This is a good tension, and one that runs through all that we do in RTÉ. Some, mainly our competitors, wish it were simpler, that RTÉ could operate by licence fee alone, like the BBC, and leave the commercial marketplace to others. But the truth is, this country doesn't have the population to sustain such an economic model. So, like many other territories, Ireland adopts a dual funding approach. The alternative would be to either double the licence fee or drop half of our output. I think the former would be asking too much of people, and the latter would be like asking people to choose which part of the power network we should switch off. The big parts that serve the cities or all the fiddly little bits that serve the rest of the country. Of course, the argument for dual funding really only stacks up if RTÉ is efficient and transparent in its use of both public funding and commercial income. I don't think anyone would thank me tonight for going into a detailed analysis of RTÉ's cost efficiencies or value for money, but I do think it's worth giving a few comparative examples and facts to illustrate the point. Most of these examples are from a new report by PricewaterhouseCoopers that we will be publishing next week. Among other things, it found that RTÉ had reduced its cost by 18% in the past two years. The BBC reduced its cost by 4% and Channel 4 by 2%. RTÉ has added 472 million to the Irish economy last year. Close to 40% of licence fee income received by RTÉ last year reverted to the state in some form of tax. We have one of the lowest licence fees per capita in Western Europe. The BBC sent 295 staff to the Soccer World Cup in South Africa. ITV sent 150 staff, RTÉ sent 11, but delivered twice the number of live matches. Fair City is produced at one-fifth the cost of BBC Casualty and half the cost of EastEnders, yet has the highest rating of any soap in Ireland. The average TV share of public service media across the EU is 28%. RTÉ achieves 33%, one of the highest across all EU countries. Of course, these are just examples. We report on them each year in our financial performance, in our annual report and our group financial statements. We also give a full operational review of each service, a summary report on our agreed performance commitments, and how we allocate commercial income and public funding by both service and genre. We report monthly management accounts, and as I detailed earlier, we have a number of additional reporting processes with the BAI. That's not to say that RTÉ is perfect in this regard. As an organisation, RTÉ has not always been as transparent as it should have been, and there is a perceptional legacy that continues for many. However, for anyone who really chooses to look, RTÉ is now one of the most transparent media organisations operating in the jurisdiction, as it should be. However, what has become all too transparent is that RTÉ suffered steep declines in its commercial revenue since 2008. When recession bit, the fall off in broadcasting advertising in Ireland was the most extreme in Europe. RTÉ experienced a sudden loss of 70 million in annual commercial revenues from mid-2008. We responded by rapidly cutting costs. Our staff were the first among the public sector to volunteer pay cuts. We cut 82 million or 18% off our cost base. The rest of the semi-state sector reduced theirs by 6%. Staff numbers were reduced by 200. We suffered a substantial reduction in public funding in the budget last December, and commercial revenue also fell. And with unplanned external factors, including the two state visits, that subsequently pushed our potential deficit up to €34 million. We cut again, and RTÉ is now on target to reduce that by half this year, with further restructuring planned for next year, designed to ensure break-even in 2013. While this will be difficult, I'm certainly not expecting any sympathy or seeking any credit for what we have achieved to date. It's not a time for pats on the back. I know many organisations, including media organisations, are also hurting. Indeed, a number have gone out of business. But it is clear that any additional substantial cut in public funding will make it impossible for us to fulfil our public service commitments. So there you have it, a perfect RTÉ, a role model for all other broadcasters, noble in purpose, honourable indeed. I wish it was always so. There is no reference manual for a dual-funded public service broadcaster. No rule book you pull down off the top shelf when you have to make decisions on the shape of a schedule or what commercial income to chase or how vigorously we should chase it. RTÉ certainly hasn't always got it right. We haven't always balanced our competitive and non-competitive imperatives properly. We haven't always shaped our schedules as we should. We were slow to fully realise the impact of the recession on our commercial rivals and to examine the wider role we play in the domestic market. We were complacent in not making the case for a strong national public service broadcaster forcefully enough to both the public and our stakeholders as public funding was reduced over the past number of years. We let top talent fees become too large. We have been too closed at times in our history, too conservative, or perhaps too reluctant to work with others, particularly other cultural institutions that also play a key role as keepers of Irish culture and Irish identity, and whose work we could greatly amplify and support. All of this will change over the next 3 years. It is already changing. However, there are mistakes that are more difficult to offer guarantees on. Sometimes, despite our best efforts, we make editorial misjudgments and editorial mistakes. These are the mistakes that we most regret because of the harm they can cause, the trust that is broken with our audience, and the confidence that is shaken in our programme teams. As many of you here tonight will no doubt have seen, a little over a week ago, RTÉ made a lengthy apology on air just after the 9 o'clock news. The matter is still before the courts and is therefore sub judice, which is why RTÉ has made no public comment on it. However, I would like to take this opportunity to publicly and unreservedly, as Director General of RTÉ, apologise to Father Kevin Reynolds. RTÉ must always be open and honest when we get it wrong. We must learn what we can from such mistakes and make changes if necessary, and we will. That is part of being accountable and essential to public trust and public support. However, what is also part of maintaining public trust is that we don't lose our nerve. Investigative journalism is one of the key contributions of media to our society. I've been involved in investigative journalism as a reporter, a producer, an editor, and a manager at various times since I left DCU. If I've learned anything during that period, it's that delivering quality investigative programming is incredibly risky, contentious, and difficult. There is no low-hanging fruit. Most of the time, you dig these stories out of a granite pit, stone by stone. That is part of the reality of working in this area, and the stakes are high. We are often revealing matters that impinge hugely on our subjects. The burden of responsibility that brings is considerable. It's a responsibility we accept because it's part of our job, part of RTÉ's essential public service. Society needs this reporting. Investigative journalism is and will remain a core priority in RTÉ's output. I mentioned at the beginning of my remarks this evening that if RTÉ is to continue to remain relevant to the everyday lives of Irish people, and fulfil its public service obligations, it will have to adapt. Some of the changes we are now making have been hastened by the very difficult financial position that RTÉ finds itself in. We must adjust to a new financial reality. Getting RTÉ back on a firm and sustainable financial footing has to be our first priority, and everyone in RTÉ understands that. We are working our way through this, and as I have outlined, we've made very significant progress. However, there are a number of realities that are now very clear. To date, RTÉ has been very good at minimising the impact of cost reductions on our services. But the scale of the readjustments we have to achieve in the next 18 months means that service levels will be impacted and most likely reduced. By the end of this year, RTÉ will be a significantly smaller organisation, some 300 people smaller than it was in 2008. This has implications for all areas for the future within RTÉ and requires a fundamental restructuring of our operations, which is currently underway. By 2013, RTÉ will have reduced its top talent fees by an excess of 30%. We may, during this process of renegotiation, lose some of our most talented and loved presenters to our competitors. That would be very regrettable. But if some choose to leave, we will adjust, find new voices and new ways to deliver services and programmes into the future. The key message here is that we will meet our public service obligations, but we will do so by doing things differently, by being more efficient, by being more focused. Key in all of this is having very clear priorities, for it is only by having priorities that we can make consistent decisions, particularly when scaling back some activities. This is nowhere more important than an RTÉ's output, which is the key to everything that we do. When I came into this role earlier this year, I communicated to staff my intention and put in train a process to choose clear output priorities that RTÉ will protect and enhance over the next 3 years. This process concluded last week, and tonight I would like to announce those six priorities. The first of these I have already referred to this evening, and that is investigative journalism. The others are arts and culture, because RTÉ has a unique role within Ireland's cultural ecosystem. Innovation, including science and technology, because RTÉ must be part of building Ireland's new future. Children and young people, because they are our future. 24-hour news on demand, because we must meet the needs of our audience, who are increasingly mobile and sophisticated in the digital age. National events, because RTÉ must always be in a place that brings people together. These priorities are clearly aligned with RTÉ's stated values and principles and are aligned with our responsibilities in law. They are also content and output areas where we can be distinctive, where we can serve a clear public interest and make a real public impact. Over the next 3 years, audiences will notice new programming and new content in those areas across the full range of RTÉ services. We will develop key external partnerships to amplify the work of other public and private organisations in those areas, and we will develop new relationships with third level institutions. And internally, we will develop new talent, allocate and coordinate resources, and support staff development in these priority areas. Combined, they are an affirmation of RTÉ's obligations to help sustain Irish culture, to uphold the public interest, to remain relevant to the daily lives of our audience, and to contribute to Ireland's renewal and sense of common purpose. Combined, these output priorities give a clear signal to our audience as to what RTÉ regards as core to its public purpose at this moment in time. They are a very clear statement of RTÉ's intent in the future. Just as what we choose to focus on informs public understanding of RTÉ's core purpose, so too does how we act in the marketplace. I am very aware of the privileged position that RTÉ is in, particularly in the current economic environment. I realise not just the benefits, but the responsibilities that public funding confers on us. As I have said, we haven't always balanced our competitive and non-competitive imperatives properly. We are dependent on commercial income to provide the range of output we offer. We are also legally constituted to pursue that income, and we will continue to do so. However, there will be clear changes in our commercial approach in the coming years. Our online activities have been hugely successful for us and have become a vital link to new audiences both in Ireland and overseas. We will be developing exciting new online content and services, but our online activities will also increasingly reflect our overall public service obligations. The remit of RTÉ Digital, our new online division, will be a dual remit as applies to all of our output areas. We will be more conscious of our overall role in the broadcasting landscape and the role of our subsidiary companies. We are, for instance, aware of criticism of the relationship between RTÉ and its subsidiary, RTÉNL. We are open to examining how we might put a greater degree of separation between parent and subsidiary. This will be important as new regulation designed for transmission in the digital age is framed. We will become more open to broadcast partnerships and collaborations around key areas of content like sports rights and new digital television services. We announced earlier this year an offer of content to members of the National Newspapers of Ireland on a pilot basis. This was an entirely new departure for RTÉ. Those discussions are now progressing on an individual basis with individual newspaper groups. Our goal is to seek mutually beneficial partnerships with companies and organisations that have an interest like us in the provision of quality Irish content. Our goal is to be more open to the possibilities of sharing RTÉ content with a wider audience on terms that benefit both parties. We would expect further content partnerships to be agreed in the coming months. And following our review of all of our commercial trading activities that we launched last March, by the middle of next year, we will have developed a new approach to our commercial trading that is transparent and appropriate to a publicly funded organisation of our size within this market. This is the shape of public service media in the future. More partnerships that operate in the public interest, more awareness of the responsibilities that public funding brings, while at the same time being more innovative and strategic in our commercial approach. This is the challenge facing all public service media organisations over the next decades. Another change, perhaps the most exciting one that our audiences will notice over the next number of years, will be in our digital services. By this time next year, on the eve of analogue switch off, which means every household across the country will need to make the switch to new digital television. Analogue switch off marks a defining moment in the evolution of Irish media. We are literally crossing a threshold into a new digital age. Earlier this year, RTÉ launched Serview, thereby ensuring Irish households will continue to have access to free-to-air television after ASO. RTÉ launched a number of new channels on that service, RTÉ Junior, an advertising-free children's channel, News Now, a news channel, RTÉ 2 HD, and RTÉ 1 Plus 1. Serview, of course, also carries TV3, 3E, and TG Cahir. In radio, RTÉ has led and will continue to lead the innovation and has established the potential of digital radio in Ireland. We have made all of our services available online and on demand. This has allowed more channels, more choice, and more control for the listener in how and when they access our radio content. In future, we will be developing other additions to accompany the new online radio player launched just today. There are huge possibilities now. Many of the old barriers are really falling. Exciting hybrid TV and radio services in areas such as culture and arts, archive, documentary, sport, film, and drama are now all possible. However, if audiences are to benefit from the full potential that these technologies allow, it will require a more flexible, creative, and collaborative approach by various broadcasters, regulators, and government. A few weeks ago, I announced to staff a fundamental reorganisation of how we are to deliver our existing online services and develop new ones. Audiences will notice in the future that our online content will become richer, more social, and more comprehensive. RTÉ can and will play a leading role at the centre of this new, growing, creative digital economy. To do this, to remain competitive, and to continue to give our audiences the best possible services, RTÉ will soon have to invest in new facilities, built to meet the demands of the digital age. It will be a number of months before we are in a position to make definitive decisions on how best to proceed, but we are planning ahead for the future, a future where public service media continues to be at the very heart of Irish life. Earlier tonight, I spoke about those things that, as a society, we have already lost. Some we will regain, some will take longer, if ever, to recover. As we stand on the cusp of a new age in Ireland, we must all choose what to take with us and what to leave behind. While making those choices, we must keep more than ourselves in mind. We must make a place for the public good in our deliberations. RTÉ firmly sees itself as an instrument of public good. That is the intention of the regulation that binds us, the licence fee that funds us, and the people who serve us. I believe I speak for all of RTÉ staff when I say that we are more determined than ever to live up to that expectation of public good. We realise what is at stake and what we all have to lose if we fail. RTÉ is going through a profound change. It must do so to reflect the society it serves. But as we do, we will make sure to bring with us into the future those elements that have earned us the trust and loyalty of our audiences. We have learned and will continue to learn from our mistakes so that we can continue to enrich and deepen our connection with the Irish public. We will also continue to seek ways to increase the value we provide for the funding we receive. Our position is a privileged one, one we know we must continue to earn. But while we seek better and more efficient ways of doing things, we will not compromise on the content we produce. Because a society that makes the courageous and noble choice of funding public service media deserves to have that decision rewarded with the very best that that funding can provide. RTÉ's core position in public service media provision will ensure that this society continues to have rich conversations with itself, that the marginalised will be included in those conversations and will be represented. It will ensure that in an age of dizzying information supply, one stream will run free of agenda and free of market forces. It will ensure that we celebrate together when those bright moments come and that we share our disappointments when they don't. It will ensure that while all around us changes, we have something to go to that reflects those changes, explains them, discusses them, and gives us a platform on which to find a collective way forward. But most of all, at a time when the globe has become a village, a strong, relevant RTÉ will provide us with that sense of ourselves which Irish people cherish so dearly. Our history, our culture, our heritage, and the expressions and iterations of ourselves that make us who we are. RTÉ will be home to them all. Thank you very much.
There's just so much there to think about, to be provoked by, and to think about responding to. It would be dangerous of me to even start to think of a response now. There's something to critique there for everybody, something to agree with perhaps. But I thank Noel for the breadth and depth of his address. I thank him for asking, I suppose implicitly but very directly, how much do we value the institution of public service broadcasting? Public service media now, we must call it. And I very much hope that tonight will be the start of a new debate about the future of our state broadcaster and what it ought to be doing and how we ought to pay for it. So I'll end by thanking Noel again and inviting those of you who got tickets on registration to join us on the second floor for some refreshments. Thank you all very much indeed. And thank you, Noel.
Very well, thank you.